Would you pray with me?
Dear Heavenly Father,
we give thanks to you, all the glory and praise and honor. At this time, we pray that may your Holy Spirit be upon us and stir our hearts so that we can all wake from all this spiritual sleep if we have been sleeping. Father, at this time, let us truly praise with joy and peace that you allow us to have. Father, at this time, let us remember your rewards in heaven is eternal, and then every hope of glory is for us. Father, let us be truly filled with the Holy Spirit and the Word of God through this worship in truth and spirit. We pray this in the name of Jesus in thanksgiving. Amen.
Find our Lord. I'd rather have Jesus than I. Are we ready to go, Barry? Okay. Good evening and welcome to the Covenant of Torches Wednesday night prayer service and Bible study. And what we go through my list first, and then we can add to it. Things that we should be praying for every week. We need to pray for the proclamation of the Word of Redemption history. We need to pray for our church ministries. Pray for our online ministry. Pray for Barrett Seminary regarding the accreditation with TRACS and ATS. Now let's go into the ones that truly need the prayer. First, keep in prayer David Murmur and his wife, Rebecca, and family. He took a bad fall, and I guess he was in critical care, but he's now home today. So keep them in prayer. Pray for Evangelist Sophia. Her grandmother just passed away at the age of 93. So it was time for the Lord, I guess, to bring her home. Pray for all those that were affected by the attack on 9/11. Remember, Friday is the anniversary of the 9/11 in New York City when we were attacked. I have one. Also pray for Sophia herself as she gives the class tonight. We do have one praise report, and that's Elizabeth Collins was promoted to the rank of major. So good for her on that one. Is there any other ones we need to add to the list? Okay. Let's go ahead and raise our hands up. Who? Okay. And pray for the Wissinger family as they continue to mourn for their grandmother that passed away a couple weeks ago. Okay. So pray for them. Okay, let's go ahead and put our hands up. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God. Let's see that you give us we can meet tonight, Father, to put on this video, Father, for those that have that they have a way to receive this precious word today, Father. Father, we thank you for keeping us all safe as you bring us back into your house tonight, Father. And Father, we ask that you be with us tonight, Father, from start to finish, Father. Praise those that come here to give of their time, Father, to put on this video, Father. Father, we pray for the proclamation of the Word of Redemption history. Let it be heard around the world, Father God. And Father, we pray for proclamation of the Word of Redemption history. We pray for the church ministries, new meetings. We pray for Barrett Seminary regarding accreditation and tracks. And Father God, we pray for David Brewer and his wife, Rebecca, as he's recovering from a bad fall, Father. Keep him safe. Get him strong and he come back to us, Father God. Pray for Sophia as she presents tonight's class of us. Pray for all those who are affected by the night. And thank you for Elizabeth Collins and their promotion to major, Father God. We just give you the glory, always, Father God. We thank you, Father. Being there, Father, to listen to our prayers, Lord God. Oh, Father, we know that you are listening to our prayers tonight, Father, as we get to forward, Father God. Thank you for all the praise, Father. Father, we pray that this lecture tonight, Father, will be pleasing to your ears, Father. Let it open up our ears, Father, so we can hear. Open up our hearts. So grateful, Father. And Father, we also pray for the Wissinger family, Father. Let them be strong in this time of need, Father God. touch them, Father. Touch them. Give them strength and the power to continue on, Father God. Father, we just remember, Father, you are watching over us tonight, Father, as we go into this prayer session, Father. We know that you are listening with all you have. Father God, we again thank you for bringing us into your house tonight to put on this live broadcast so those at home could continue to receive this precious word. Father, as we present this word today, Father, we pray that you will find it pleasing to you, Father. Father, we do this in your glory, Father. We lift you up and give you all the praise tonight, Father. And Father, we bring all those names we prayed for earlier to you, Father. We place them in your hands, Father, for we know that you have the solution for all the problems. And Father, we pray for our Evangelist Sophia as she presents this word tonight, Father. And Father, we just ask that you will open up the ears to let us hear and the heart to receive this word tonight. And Father, we just need to be worried but not afraid, Father, as you tell us. Just put things in your hands and you will take care of it for us. And Father, we thank you for the first responders as they give their lives and sometimes protecting others, Father. And Father, we pray for all these riots all across the country, Father, that we know that you're in control, Father. We just ask that you will touch them, Father, and open up their eyes. Father, we just say thank you. We come here to glorify you tonight, Father, and to get closer to you in your precious word. And all these things we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. The scripture reading tonight is coming from Ezekiel 41, verses 1 through 5. Then he brought me into the sanctuary and measured the doorpost. 6 cubits wide on one side, 6 cubits wide on the other side. The width of the tabernacle. The width of the entryway was 10 cubits, and the side walls of the entrance were 5 cubits on this side, 5 cubits on the other side. And he measured its length, 40 cubits, and its width, 20 cubits. Also he went inside and measured the doorpost, 2 cubits, and the entrance, 6 cubits high, and the width of the entrance, 7 cubits. He measured the length, 20 cubits, and the width, 20 cubits. Beyond the sanctuary, and he said to me, "This is the most holy place." Next, he measured the wall of the temple, 6 cubits, and the width of each side of the chamber all around the temple was 4 cubits on every side. Amen. At this time, Evangelist Sophia will come and give us the 15th lesson on Ezekiel's temple, the perfect squares of 100 cubits.
Hallelujah. Okay. So today we have a print out both in English and Korean. I hope you all got it. And then those who want this printout, just for your reference, if you want, just ask us through Facebook or email, then we will send it to you by email, all these PDF files. So today, based upon Ezekiel chapter 41, verses 1 through 5, we would like to share the message, the perfect squares of 100 cubits. Let's go over what we have learned so far. Last week, we have learned about this perfect squares of 100 cubits inside of the inner court, okay? So this blue box we can see is a building on the west. And today we're gonna think about this red zone, which you can find the temple. And that this blue zone will be the inner court with the altar of burnt offering. And then again, if you look from the sky, then there are three perfect squares, 100 cubits by 100 cubits. For your reference, this is the outer court. This outer court is 100 cubits in width as well. But these are very wide gate. So excluding this gate area, there's a perfect square of 100 cubits. And then again, we have learned about this Western building, and the Bible only records about interior, size of interior. It was 70 by 90, but because there the thickness of the wall was 5 cubits, and because it has both sides, so you have to add 10 each. Then you get 80 by 100. That's the size of the building. But this area must include this separate area of 20 cubits as well. So if you include those, you get perfect square of 100, right? And today we'll think about this sanctuary. The perfect square centered with the sanctuary. So let me explain from, this is the image from the book. There are many, many boxes, small boxes. What are those? These are chambers, side chambers. So it looks very complicated, but I'm so happy that I could find an easier way to calculate this. So have a hope, so stay with me. Shall we read Ezekiel chapter 41, verses 13? Ready, go. So he measured the temple 100 cubits long. Verse 14, also the width of the front of the temple and that of the separate areas along the east side totaled 100 cubits. So just keep it in mind. This 10 steps in front of the building is not included in this 100 cubits of perfect square. So if you, this is included with the altar burnt offering. So only this side, these separate areas on each side, and the sanctuary will be included in this perfect square. That's why the Bible records 100 cubits and 100 cubits, but we're gonna see how it becomes 100 cubits for north to south and east to west. So let me explain with the video.
And then the length from the east to west for the temple, 5 cubits for the side pillars at the porch, 12 cubits for the porch itself, according to the Septuagint, not the Masoretic text. And also,
so if you enter here, then there is a porch.
6 cubits.
And then this is the holy place, and this is the Holy of Holies, 20 cubits long. And you have inner wall. But between the outer wall and inner wall, there's the side chambers.
Side chambers, 4 cubits thick. Outer wall, 5 cubits.
So from east to west, it's 100 cubits. And from north to south, because the width of the holy place is 20. Now you have inner wall and side chambers and outer walls. Then you will see this empty space.
And the free space around the side chambers.
Then you will see the separate area.
And 20 cubits of the separate area on the north and the south. Adding together, we get total 100 cubits from the north.
So we will explain those details. Big number one, we're going to think about the east to west. The length of the temple from east to west You have to add 9 things. The thickness of the porch of the temple, the length of the porch, 12 cubits, the thickness of the wall of the entry to the holy place, the length of the holy place, 40 cubits, the thickness of the wall of the doorway of the Holy of Holies. There's a thin wall between the holy place and then Holy of Holies. And the length of the Holy of Holies, 20 cubits. The thickness of the inner wall of the temple was 6 cubits. The length of the side chambers is 4 cubits. The thickness of the outer wall of the temple is 5 cubits. So what is the porch? What is the porch? Vestibule or porch is a small foyer leading into a larger space. A vestibule or a porch is a small foyer leading into a larger space. For example, when you are in the restaurant and you are waiting for your order, your seat. So there is a waiting area, you know, car wash or restaurant or the hotel. And then in Korean or Japanese house, you put your shoes and then take it off and put your umbrella, wet umbrellas over there, and then enter into the house. That kind of area, sometimes beautifully adorned with the flowers and mirrors, that's the porch. So not like the tabernacle in Moses' tabernacle, there was the porch in front of the holy place. So number one, the thickness of the porch of the temple. It was 5 cubits. You see the red zone? It's marked with the red. It's the 5 cubits. And then if you look through the 3D, it's here. These are the walls. But we don't call it a pillar, because NASB version or other Bibles are calling this sometimes a side pillars. That might be very confusing to you. But instead of pillar, we like to call it as the doorpost of the vestibule or just a wall. It's just a side wall that would be the more accurate. Can you read Ezekiel chapter 40, 48? It's a New King James Version. Ready, go. Then he brought me to the vestibule of the temple and measured the doorpost of the vestibule, 5 cubits on this side and 5 cubits on that side. And then actually there's 2 pillars here. So it's different from the side walls. Number 2, the length of the porch is 12 cubits. So if you go into that porch or vestibule, it's the 12 cubits long. So ESV version says 12 cubits, but Korean Bible or any Bible versions taking the Masoretic Hebrew text, it will say 11 cubits. But don't be confused, because according to the Septuagint translation, Septuagint is sometimes called LXX because that means the 70. And it was translated by 70, around the 70 people from Hebrew to Greek. It's the Greek Old Testament. And that says the length of the porch was 20 cubits and the breadth was 12 cubits. In Greek, it's dodeca. Dodeca, it means 12, like 12 disciples. That's why ESV version takes 12 cubits instead of 11. So when Dr. Abram Park calculated all this length of the temple, 12 cubits were more accurate. It was more accurate version. So keep it in mind. Then finally we are entering the holy place, but there is a thick wall of the entry as well. That's the 6 cubits. 6 cubits. Now you are in the holy place, and it's 40 cubits long. The length of the holy place, It's 40 cubits. And now we are ready to enter the Holy of Holies, most holy place. And then there is another wall makes entry. The thickness of the wall of the doorway to the Holy of Holies is the thinnest one, 2 cubits, just 2 cubits. It's about 1 meter. And sixth, the length of the Holy of Holies is 20 cubits. The Holy of Holies is also a perfect square, a 20 by 20. So the holy place was 40 cubits, and the Holy of Holies is 20 cubits. Seventh, can we read Ezekiel chapter 41, verses 4 and 2? We're going to read the verse 4 first, and then verse 2. Ready, go. And he measured its length 20 cubits, and the width 20 cubits before the nave. And he said to me, this is the most holy place. Ezekiel chapter 41, verse 2. And he measured the length of the nave 40 cubits, and the width 20 cubits. See, sometimes this holy place is called as the nave. That's not the most holy place, but just a holy place. So it's 20-20 and 40-20. So God is merciful and he makes it easier to remember, right? It's not just a random number like 343 like that. Okay, seventh, now the thickness of the inner wall of the temple is 6 cubits. The inner wall of the temple was 6 cubits. And then you see the side chambers, it's 4 cubits. Side chambers is 4 cubits. And then lastly, you will have the outer wall. So let's read Ezekiel chapter 41, verses 5. Ready, go. Then he measured the wall of the temple 6 cubits. The width of the side chambers, 4 cubits, all around about the house on every side. This house means the sanctuary. So when it says the wall of the temple, it was inner wall. Finally, the thickness of the outer wall of the temple is 5 cubits. Inner wall is 6, but outer wall was 5 cubits. Now I promise to introduce an easier way to understand. You know, maybe you should try, instead of cubits, just count it with the dollars. I'm really bad about grocery shopping. I round up everything. If it is $11.99, I remember like it's about $10. But you guys are all better than me calculating all these things. So instead of cubits, try to put dollars. It gets more easier. You always calculate these things, so remember, it's not a really difficult study. It's not that hard, okay? And then if you just categorize these 9 elements, then it gets easier to add up. So you see these 3 colors, red, green, and blue, right? This blue zone is the holy place, and then most holy place is 40 plus 20. Then you get 60 cubits. And then how about this green zone? This porch and side chambers, these are like the rooms. If you add up just the rooms together, then $12 plus $4, how much you get? Yeah, $16. And then if you add up all these walls, red lines, and then go with this order. instead of this, but add up from here. $5 plus $5, $10, right? Okay, and then $6 plus $6, $12. And 12 plus 2 means $14. And because you have 5 plus 5, you have 10 more. Then total $24. If you just joined the YouTube service, you would have no idea what we were talking about. So instead of cubits, we're trying to calculate it with dollars because it's just familiar with us, right? So again, God knows us. We don't like calculation, right? So instead of 5 plus 12 plus 6 plus 40 plus 2 plus 20 plus 6 plus, it's 4 plus 5. Just add up 24 plus 16. Then you get 40. And 60 plus 40, then you get 100. That's why from east to west, you get 100 cubits. Okay, so there is a chart in the 11th book, but if you reorder it, like I just introduced, then 40 plus 20, you get 60. And 5 plus 5, you get 10. 6 plus 6 plus 2, you get 14. 10 plus 14, you get 24. Then, all these rooms, 4 plus 12, you get 16. So, because these are, makes 40, 60 plus 40 is 100 cubits. That's the easier way to understand. Now we're gonna think about the length from north to south. Longitudinal length. The temple from north to south, also 100 cubits. Now it's more, it's much more easier to understand because it does the same structure from north and south. So you get just half of it, then you double it. So it's easy. And then you have just 5 20s. See? You have the separate area, 20 cubits wide. And then you have a free space, 5 cubits. Thickness of the outer wall of the temple, 5 cubits. Then you get 10. And the width of the side chambers, 4. The thickness of the inner wall, 6. So you get 10. So if you 10 plus 10 means another 20, right? And the width of the Holy of Holies, the most holy place, was 20 cubits, right? And again, this part is just same as the north part. So you get another 20 here. Then last one, the separate area, is another 20. So 20 plus 20 plus 20 plus 20 plus 20 is 100. So let me go into the detail. We're going to start from the center. The width of the Holy of Holies was 20 cubits. And the thickness of the inner wall, both sides, is 6. This was 20, and both sides, 6 cubits. Then you get what? Side chambers, right? The side chambers, the width is each one was 4 cubits. The Holy of Holies was 20. Inner wall was 6 cubits. And then now side chambers at 4. Then the width of the empty space is 5 cubits. Okay? So this is 20, 6, 4, and 5. The outer wall is 5, and the empty space is 5. Now the separate areas for both sides, north and south, you have 20 cubits. So if you put it together, it looks like this, right? The separate area was 20 cubits, and this empty space 5, outer wall 5, and side chamber 4, and inner wall 6. So it's another 20 cubits. The Holy of Holies was 20 cubits. And then this one is the same. That's why it's 100 cubits. Let's explain with, So this is the porch area. And then there's a
the entrance
thickness
the
of the wall was
six cubits thick of the wall and 10 cubits wide. And the both side pillars are 5 cubits wide.
And then you are entering the holy place. And the holy place was supposed to have the altar of incense and table of the bread and golden lampstand, but there is nothing except this wooden altar.
Holy place.
And it was 40 cubits long.
20 cubits wide and 40 cubits long.
Now finally we are entering the Holy of Holies, and then this thickness of the wall is only 2 cubits, thinnest. So this
the
one
entrance
is
to the most holy place is
two cubits
thick, 6 cubits wide. The both side pillars, 7 cubits.
So ready to enter the most holy place? There's no Ark of Covenant,
and
right?
This is the most holy place.
Only the cherubim and palm trees are engraved. And this is another perfect square of 20 by 20.
The most holy place is 20 cubits long, 20 cubits wide.
Then you will have inner wall and side chambers and outer wall. That's it. See? So instead of all these numbers, so remember, you get 100, and 520s, then you get 100. So if we summarize these perfect square of the temple, we can see that these temple was built accurately and perfectly. Well, about the Bible, we say, I'm so blessed. We talk about the mercy of God when we read the Bible, and we talk about mysteries of the God. But we don't talk about the accuracy. I didn't hear a lot of people saying, the Bible is so scientific, so organized. But actually, the Bible is so organized and perfect, and it's so accurate. So Psalm 122, verses 3, Dr. Abram Park put this verse about this temple area. Jerusalem, that is built as a city that is compact together. It praises its accuracy. So have you ever heard about the inerrancy of the Bible? There's no error in the Bible, right? There's no single error, not 99%, but 100%. That's the word of God. That's why it's so perfect. Just until now, we couldn't just see. And ultimately, Ezekiel's temple is the last temple we will enter, right? And when we think about the temple, when we study about temple, we shouldn't forget about this. In John chapter 2, Jesus said, I am the temple, right? Basically, he said that. Remembering that, temple shows the Son of Man, person, right?
eventually it shows a person as well. How Jesus, God our Father, and God's kingdom, and the Bible, God's word, are accurate and perfect and just and righteous, right? So when we think about this, I'm just amazed, and I realized that for such a warm as I, who am I? For such a warm as I, God granted this precious word to me. No matter how I eager to hear it, if God does not allow or grant it, bestow it, I can't hear it, I can't see it, but with our eyes I can see it. With my ears I can hear it. And then I can read it, right? All the prophets until now, they wanted to hear what we hear. They wanted to see what we see, and they wanted to learn what we have learned. So we are looking at this and measuring it by God's grace. So I'm so thankful. Let us not forget this grateful and thankful heart. So we are precious treasure box of God's word. And as a conclusion, let us think about the redemptive historical lessons. There were three perfect squared structures. And the first one was the western part of the building. And because west side means the place where sun sets, there's no sun over there, the place where sun sets, and it is not the right side, but left side, and it's a place of curse in the Bible, not a blessing. So isn't this perfect squared portion showing us that God's righteous judgment? God's judgment is righteous and always perfect. And we were crying and sharing our tears because of this unrighteous and evil people, evil force of the devil, right? And then second portion, this is the sanctuary. The holy place, the holy of holies, it signifies God himself, the word of God, incarnated word, Jesus Christ, right? And he is perfect figure, and he is righteous. So his word is just fair, righteous, and he wipes away our tears. He's the one. And then lastly, this inner court, thirdly, inner court with the altar of burnt offering was also a perfect square, which means justice, righteousness, fairness, perfectness. And the altar of burnt offering signifies the cross. So this grace of atonement that is given to us without a price is equal to everybody. Everybody's open to this opportunity to be redeemed. But there's no discrimination. So let's read Revelation 19, verse 2 together. Ready, go. Because his judgments are true and righteous. His judgments are true and righteous. And Romans chapter 3, 21 and 22 praises his righteousness that is given through a faith in Jesus Christ. In other words, faith in the atonement of the cross. Ready? Go. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. For all those who believe, for there is no distinction. Amen? There's no discrimination. There's no distinction for the grace of the cross. Now, the second lesson we can learn from this perfect square is the fullness of God. Because the size of this perfect square is 100 cubits by 100. And this 100, 10 by 10 is 100. And number 10 means fullness. So we have to know that this 100 is a symbol of fullness. It reveals the perfection and fullness of God. Today we must live with the fullness of God in all our lives. Number one, there's a fullness of God we can find.
If it is not full, what does it mean? Something is lacking. But there is no lack with God. Therefore, if we live with God, our lives will not be lacking. That's why in Psalm 23, verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Living with the fullness of God means our lives will be truly satisfied. Falsely? No, truly satisfied. So Ephesians chapter 3, 19. Can we read it together? Shall we? Ready, go. And to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. And this fullness of God is found in Jesus. We want to receive this fullness of God. We want to live with this fullness of God. But where is the fullness of God? It is found in Jesus. If we drift away from Jesus, we cannot receive the fullness of God. So Colossians chapter 1:19 says, "For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him." Who is him? Jesus. Also Colossians chapter 2, verse 9. Ready, go. "For in him all the fullness of deity dwells in bodily form." So only when we abide in Jesus, his fullness will be our fullness. And this fullness of God was granted to Jesus, and in Jesus we can enjoy the fullness of God, but this fullness of God is only found in church as well. The fullness in Jesus is also found in church. The fullness of God in Jesus is filled the church, because the church is the body of his. Because he is the head over all things to the church. Ephesians chapter 1, 22 to 23 says that, right? So his body, the church, the fullness of him who fills all in all, it is found in church. That's why it's so different. We can have worship at home. Our home must be the place of worship as well. But yeah, but when we gather together here in church, we can experience the glory of God. God's presence, God's power pouring out to me, the fullness of God that is not found in the world, the outside of church, it will be richly dwelling in us. So when we come to church, our emptiness, this void will be made full, and all our wants will be satisfied. God promises various types of fullness in us. God gives the fullness of the Holy Spirit. First, God gives us the fullness of the Holy Spirit. So Ephesians 5:18 says, "Be filled with the Holy Spirit." And secondly, there is the fullness of the Word. Colossians 3:16 says, "Let the Word of Christ richly dwell within you." God promises the fullness of the Word. So let's say if you are baking a bread, the whole house is filled with this freshly baked bread, right? So yummy, we want to just eat, right, when it is hot. Likewise, when we are filled with this Word of God, this fragrance, aroma of the Word of God must be smelled from others. And this is the smell of our, not mother's soup, but our hometown, heaven. When people are smelling this freshly baked bread, then where is it? Where is it? I want to take one bite, right? They come to the source of the smell. Likewise, when they smell this fragrance of the Word of God, they come nearer, nearer to the heaven. That's why they can find a way to the Father. Also, God promises God will fill us with grace and power. All these seven first deacons, they were full of grace and power. Acts chapter 6, verse 8 says that, right? And there's a fullness of faith. Acts chapter 11, 24 talks about Barnabas. He was full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. There's a fullness of faith. And now there's a fullness of joy. Acts chapter 13, 52, the disciples were continually filled with joy. This is important. Were continually. It's not one-time thingy, but continually. And also, it's not active voice, but passive voice. I was reading a book about cultural differences with misreading the Bible with the Western eyes. And then it was saying that American people like the active voice, just put it in a simple way, right? But the Bible actually uses a lot of passive voices because it is done by God. It's by God's grace. We want to try, but it is only by God's grace, right? So we shouldn't be the people who are rejecting God's grace. And we have to remember, if we are the people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with the Word and grace and power and faith, then we must be the person with fullness of joy as well. So whenever we lost joy in our hearts, we have to think about, wait a minute, my heart is so darkened. Now it's so cold. What happened? I have no joy in my heart. I'm not rejoicing in the Lord. So it's because I'm looking at the earthly things, worldly things. I have to fix my eyes upon Jesus. Fix the things up above. Seek the things above. But we're looking down to earthly things, and now the worries and concerns come into our hearts. Somebody's sick, we don't have money, we're not the filthy, wealthy people. But we don't have to worry, no matter what kind of troubles we might have in our lives. These are temporary, momentary things, right? It's not eternal pain. That's our hope. That's why we have hope of glory for heaven. And there is a great reward waiting for you, like the children of CEOs of Samsung, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, whatever, then they are rich people. But we are the children of our God the Father, who have all things in His hand, who created all things. So we are already rich people. We have the richness of the world of redemptive history. We're all rich people. So there's nothing can stop our joy. So we sing, right? We got the joy, 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 Mar. And then there's a joy like a river. There's a joy like a river. Because we have this eternal joy, cannot be hindered by anything, anything. So we have to actually fight for the fullness of joy. Whenever we lose this peace and joy continually filled by God's grace, right? Then we're looking at something else. So we have to just rethink about it, and we have to fight for our fullness of joy. When Philippians chapter 4:4, Apostle Paul was urging us, rejoice always. Be joyful. Rejoice. I again say to you, rejoice. Whatever. He was sued, arrested, and he was kept in jail. In prison cell, he sang hymns. How can it be? But he said that we can be joyful, right? But some people are very grouchy, grumpy, and cranky. They're always complaining and grumbling. How can they say that they are full of the Holy Spirit, full of grace and the Word of God? The ones who are filled with the Word of God and filled with grace, they are also filled with joy. So let us be the people who are filled with joy as well. So in conclusion, may we live in the fullness of God, the fullness of Jesus, the fullness of the Holy Spirit, the Word, faith, grace, power, and joy, and all where? At church. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you that you invited us to visit this precious Word of God in Ezekiel. Father, let us always be thankful and joyful, for the Lord granted us to listen and study these words, and you're changing us and measuring us through these Word of God. And by keeping these Word of God, let us be truly transfigured day by day, an inner person be newly strengthened and reborn day by day. Father, keep us to stand firm in faith, and let us look things above, and let us always think, such a worm as I have received this grace. I have received this fullness of the Holy Spirit. I have received this fullness of the gifts from heaven, our Father. Let us always rejoice in the Lord, in the Word. We are grateful forever, and in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's give God the glory.
Father God, we thank you for the blessings that you have given us, Father, especially the blessings of health, Father, in this time and troubles, Father. And Father, we know that you are watching over us, Father, day and night, protecting us, Father. And you keep blessing us, Father. Sometimes blessing we don't even realize that we've received. But Father, we know that there is no way that we could ever repay you, Father, for all that you've given us. But Father, now we collect our tithes and offerings, just a small token of what you bless us with through our life, Father. And Father, we just ask that you will show us, guide us and direct us in your ways, Father, and how we can increase your kingdom here on earth as we wait for your coming. We thank you, Father, for all that. Father, we ask that you will bless the hearts of the givers tonight, Father, as they give out a love for you and your precious word. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you. We are able to give you because you have given us so much. Father, let us always give thanks to you. And at this time, we pray that you open the heaven's gate and pour out the blessings, heavenly blessings, spiritual blessings, and physical blessings as well, so we can go well on this earth and give glory to God. Father, we want to use these resources that you have provided us to expand the kingdom of God. Those who are giving their time and tithes and offerings and their hearts and their dedications, our hands and feet and our hearts, let them be truly blessed generations to generations, and let them be filled with eternal treasures hidden from ages. Father, at this time, please help us to have the ability to obtain the material wealth as well by your grace, and let us have this material wealth without worries and concern, and let all these nations come and dance with all these offerings and gifts. We praise the name of Jesus Christ in thanksgiving. Amen.
I have no announcements tonight, unless anyone else has an announcement. If not, let's go ahead and stand and sing hymn number 1 and close with the Lord's Prayer.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, all body, every host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
That ends with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless you.